So, parasite facts, right? And I'm going to spend actually a lot more time talking about parasites than most of the other things, because I do believe, and in other countries, it's the major issue that we're having, okay? And parasites have a lot of adverse effects. They can also kill animals, right? So the major thing is what we talk about, the gin or the gastrointestinal nematodes, just a big fancy word, and coccidia are the two most common internal parasites, right? And they both have significant economic impact. And if the parasites don't kill your animals, which is the worst thing that could happen, well, people think it's the worst thing that could happen, it's actually not. If they die, to me, okay, they die. When they affect them subclinically, or what we say, they affect your production, to me, that's a bigger problem. Because I'm actually not a vet who goes around sticking animals. I'm what you call, I'm a production vet. I'm more concerned about how you make money. How does your animals make money for you than whether they die or they live? And I don't mean to sound callous, but it's the truth. Okay? When you look at a production module or something that you're doing for commerce or making money, the individual animal, and I'm a vet, but I'm being practical, the individual animal's life is not as valuable as the herd, okay? And we need to understand that, because I'm sure we're doing small ruminants to make money. We're not doing it because we're having fun. And the quicker we understand that and the economics of it in any livestock species, the better off you will be, okay? So really, the economic impact of parasites is not so much death. It's unfortunate, but it's really, what does it do affecting your the growth, the gains of your animals? Are they growing well? Does it affect their milking ability? A lot of people from Barbados are doing, and Trinidad do milk. So it can affect those things. So your animals do not produce how they should, which is of greater economic value, okay? And there is very little data on the coccidia part and the prevalence of it. There's a lot more information on the gastrointestinal nematodes, or let's just call it worms for now, okay? In the sense of intestinal worms, okay? So previously, and this is even what I learned when I was in school, what we used to do, right, is that you would deworm everybody at a precise time. Depending on the farm that you had, that's what we used to do, and we'll get it, right? So everybody used to decide, okay, I'm going to deworm every month, every 3 months, or if there are heavy rains, we're going to deworm everybody after 3 months, or after every heavy rain, or when we see one or two looking scrubby, we decide, okay, we're going to just deworm everybody. And that's what I was taught too, okay? And then we used to rotate the dewormers routinely, because if we use this one this month, okay, next month we use a different one, and we'll get into the class of the dewormers. And then often, because we didn't have scales, we would average the weight. Now, who did the averaging was important. If you average for the heaviest and then you went down, that's fine. But if you average for the middle of the road or the lightest, then you had a problem, because you were often underdosing the rest of the herd. And what happened is that you would dose everybody, assuming everybody's the same weight, which is actually incorrect, right? And then you would move everybody and then move them to a clean pasture. And now we've realized that that's causing us a big problem, because what has happened is there's a drug resistance to parasites, the worms, the internal parasites now. And I don't know how prevalent it is. I've seen it a lot in Trinidad. Jamaica has a problem. Trinidad, spent too much time on the other islands with those specific things. St. Lucia, Guyana has also had a significant problem with it. And that is worldwide. In America, it's the same thing. In New Zealand, it's the same thing. Okay? So what has happened is, because that's what we knew before, and we realized there was a problem. In other words, people were saying to you, we're deworming the animals with the same dewormers, and no new dewormer has been developed for over 70 years. What do we have now? We have what? The white ones or the milky ones, which are like what? Names. Panacure, Benvet, Hunter, okay, Albendazole, right? Right? The clear ones, which are ivermectin type things, avermectins, and the yellow one, which is the? Parentel, no, Parentel is an old one too, but all of them, the yellow one is like the levamisoles, right? And Parentel is one also, which tends to be either clear or milky, depending. So what has happened? If you can understand, we've been using the same dewormers now forever, and nothing has changed, but guess what? The worms have changed. The worms have gotten smarter. Really and truly, they have. And what has happened is they have learned the ability, and it's called selection. They have learned the ability to adapt over 70 plus years. It's the same dewormer we're using. So think about it. After a while, the worm says, boy, they're hitting us with the same thing all the time. Let's try and make a move to see what we can do. And not even that, that's what she called natural selection. Over time, the stronger worms that were not affected as badly by the dewormer would have survived. So they would stay in the population and the gut of the animal, and they would continue to multiply. So the worms have been selected and become stronger and, in essence, resistant to the dewormers that we now have. Now, there's different levels of resistance, and we'll talk about that. But once resistance is established, your dewormers are no longer effective. However, enough research was done on it now that we know that resistance can be, if you want to say, slightly reversed if you don't use the dewormers. And we'll get to that in a second. Okay? So knowing, and this is one of the gin eggs or the Himuncus contortus is really what we're talking about, or different other egg, gastrointestinal nematodes. That's what the egg looks like under a microscope. So you can't even really see these things. And those are the eggs that the animals pass out into the feces, and then they consume back the eggs on the forages that they eat. So what has happened, knowing we have resistance, and we've had several farmers, even in Jamaica, say to us, boy, doc, there's nothing more they can use, right? So that's untenable. Basically, we've had people lose flocks. We've had people shut down their operation because they just don't know what to do. But a guy in South Africa called Fafa Malan, right, he's a vet, developed something called the Famacha system. So Famacha is actually a selection of his name, F-A, Famacha, Fafa, M-A, Macha, chart. C-H-A means chart. Fafa Malan chart, called Famacha for short. It's a registered trademark name. And what he has done with that is it targets specifically Himuncus contortus, which is this barber pole worm. It's a blood-sucking worm, all right? And they call it barber pole because it has a red and white stripe, as you see. The red is the digestive gut, and the white is the reproductive gut, right? And that worm has had the most significant impact because it basically is very prolific. The female hatches thousands of eggs in its lifetime. So what happens is that when they get infected, they ingest thousands of eggs back. These eggs then hatch, and they basically suck the blood in the intestinal tract of the ruminants, okay? And so Famacha system works very well for Himuncus contortus. It doesn't work very well for the other worms like the Ostertagias and the Trichus trangulus, the different types of worms. But the major worm of significance is actually just this one, Himuncus contortus. So what the Famacha chart does, it classifies the animal on its level of anemia. And we use it by measuring the paleness of the conjunctiva on the eyes. And we'll show you all of that, okay? And what you do is you only treat animals that need to be treated. And it reduces the use of your dewormers, and then it slows the development of the resistant population of worms. Because if you only treat who needs to be treated, then the one animals that are stronger will also have worms in them, but they're not as susceptible, okay? So I'm going to actually tell you something with it. So this is a Famacha chart. It's a lot smaller right now, and I'll show you one in a little bit. It's a little chart like this now. And what they do, as you see, they measure up the color of the conjunctiva, the eye of the animal, with the color on the chart. So if the animal is, and it goes on a scale of one to five. And there's little symbols that tell you. So if they are one or two, meaning nice and red or very vibrant pink, you don't deworm. Okay? If they're pale pink or average pink, You can deworm. There's a question mark, meaning you deworm if you think you look at other things on the animal. It's body condition, it's stage of pregnancy, if it's lactating, all of those things need to be taken into consideration. And then also, you, if there are two or one is white and two is very pale pink, you have to deworm. All right? And so you measure the color of the conjunctiva of the animal. Okay? And that color of that conjunctiva, actually scientifically, that color of redness or pinkness, actually scientifically links to actually what we call a hematocrit value or a blood cell value of the animal internally. Okay, and they did a lot of work on this chart. So what we don't want is like what you see here where the animal gets pale and white. This is a young lamb that died, but it was pale and white. And when I cut that one open, there were thousands of worms in the abomasum and the lower intestinal tract. I mean, handfuls of worms that I could pick up. Okay? So that's how it can affect the animals. So I use the Fermacha system on my farm. I've used it when I was working in the US for quite a bit. I would say to you, right, the Fermacha is not a perfect system. However, there are ways of managing it. And what I tell you there, the Fermacha system is not only about the card, you know, and using the card. It's what we call we talk about integrated pest management. It's exactly like that. It's an integrated pest management program. Fermacha in itself cannot work alone. It has to work with other things. It has to work a selective deworming program, and we'll get into that right now. So other things with the Fermacha, like we said, you have to use additional techniques. For instance, you have to maintain your forages over 2 inches high, and that means requiring you to walk your pasture. Because what happens is the lower the animals graze, is the more eggs they pick up. Okay? So if you graze your pasture, you walk your pasture, and what I do sometimes is I actually measure my leg, and I kind of mark off a piece on my leg so I can walk through my pasture. Or you can walk through your pasture with a long ruler, and you kind of stab it as you go along, looking at the height of your grass. Because the lower that your animals graze, is the more parasites they will pick up. Okay, so that's one thing. Other things, you want to maintain low stocking density. Common sense. If you put more animals inside of there are more poop, more feces coming out, the level of infestation of the pasture is going to be heavier. Okay? Avoid wet areas on the pasture, right? So if you have waterlogged areas, you don't go graze your animals there. You maybe need to fence it out or drain the pasture a little better. All right? Mix grazing with other species, right? Like that, you can graze maybe cattle with sheep and goats because the cattle will pick up those same humongous eggs, but they're not as susceptible as sheep and goats. Other things, donkeys, you can graze donkeys, you can graze horses with them depending on what you have. And other options are basically just harvesting the hay instead and feeding indoors, okay? Other things I'll tell you, you can select resist. What I love about Fermacha, it's actually its own natural selection too. You are actually selecting for resistant animals. Whether you like it or not, that's what you're doing. Okay? Because what happens, I'm going to tell you, there are farms that have, and I'll tell you my personal experience, but there are farms in the US that I've worked with that over a 5-year period, basically they don't even deworm anymore. Right? Because over that years by using, and this is an intensive system, it's quite an intense thing you have to do. But if you do it after a while, you will see the improvement, okay? For instance, on my farm, I started it maybe 4 years ago, and we started using it. When we started doing it, I would say probably I would deworm 30 animals in the group that I had every 3 months or something. With Fermacha, you have to check every month. That's the only other issue, too. It's a little more intensive with labor. But when you look on it, the value of it, and I'll speak to that now, every month you have to check, no matter what. Okay? So that's another thing you have to understand. Every month you run those animals through and you check. But it doesn't take long. You just go in, check in, and you let out as you go. So I found that I started off with maybe 30 animals. Right now, we just checked last week. I maybe did 7 animals in over 100 and something females. But what has happened is anybody who I had to keep deworming, they were out of there. You're basically going to cull them. Okay? So what has happened is, and again, Fermacha cannot work if you have poor nutrition. So it's an integrated system. If your animals have poor nutrition and they're suffering, it's not going to work, because if they have poor nutrition, their immunity will drop. They're susceptible to everything, not only worms. Okay? So I'm going to tell you, again, dewormer-wise, I probably use one bottle of Ivasip or Benvet or whatever per year now. It doesn't cost me much at all. Whereas other farmers are buying large volumes of dewormers. Okay? So there are other things you can do with it, but it is not a perfect system, and I agree with you. And then another option I would say to you is that if you know you're going to let them out, deworm them before then. Like a week before, deworm them to get rid of those dormant. And there are certain dewormers you can use even in dormancy. That's the other thing too. Like you can't use Levet or Levamisole, the yellow ones. It doesn't kill dormant worms or eggs. It only kills adults. So you'd have to use like a Fenbendazole type dewormer to get those dormant larvae. You understand? So selection of your dewormer would be important. And deworming before you let out, give them a little chance, deworm, let them shed all the eggs actually in the dirty area, and then you let out. Okay?
So does that mean that every small ruminant comes established with worms?
Yeah. No, they don't come established with worms. When they go to pasture, they're going to pick up worms. But even if you keep them inside and they have feces there, again, I'm a big advocate of slatted floors. The slatted floors, because the feces falls, whether it's pigs, sheep, goat, whatever, the feces falls and they have less contact with it. But even if you house them indoors, they're going to pick it up. Okay? But what level they pick it up is different. Okay? All right. So you're going to, with Formatra, you're going to select for resistant animals, the Barbados black belly, really quite a resistant animal to Hemonchus. There are several breeds that show resistance. The Barbados black belly is one. I think the St. Croix is pretty good with it too. And this is a new breed called a Kiko goat, K-I-K-O. It was developed, I think, in Australia or New Zealand. I don't remember. New Zealand, right. It's a nondescript goat, if you ask me. It doesn't really, it's not a pretty looking goat. It's just a goat. But it's very, I mean, if you look at it there, that's a Kiko goat. It grows well, but they don't have any particular color, type, nothing. They're just a goat, you know? But they're called the Kiko. They're very resistant to parasites. Okay?
The local goat in Jamaica?
Yes, or in Trinidad or in Tobago, the local goat that could eat a car tire and probably still grow, you know? Also realize your individuals demonstrate resistance. So again, even on my herd, I can tell you already from my records, I know my females that basically every time you look at them, their eyes are like blood red. And you can look at them. Their condition is always good. They always look nice and round and plump. But we still check them. And we check them and we put them through the process, okay? And do understand that resistance has some hereditability in it. So again, if you think of it, if you start with the system and you persist with it, it is not an overnight thing. And you persist with it, over the years, you will realize your herd becomes stronger and more resistant to parasites, okay? But it does not happen overnight. So the Hemonchus was the most common parasite identified worldwide, actually, right? And it has high prevalence of resistance to your dewormers. Now, remember we said the benzimidazoles are the white ones. So the Benvet or Albendazole, the Fenbendazole, they're in the same class. It shows 98% resistance. Right? The ivermectins or macrocyclic lactones, ivermectin, Ivosip, those types, sorry, that are the clear ones. They have a 76% resistance. And then the Levamisole, which is the yellow, has 54% resistance. And what's actually nice with the Levamisole is that we found out that it's one of those that if you see resistance and you stop using it for about 2 or 3 years, the resistance is reversible, right? And they somehow again become susceptible to it. It's the only one that shows that property so far. So if you're looking at this and realizing what the data is showing you worldwide, I think the Formatra system is something that we need to employ in the Caribbean. Because I'm going to tell you, even if you start a new operation, you're going to see the problem creeping up on you bit by bit. So good point. There's a lot of talk of different alternatives. Copper oxide is one. The Syriza lespidiza is one. That's a it's actually a forage that has a lot of tannins. They also talked about, there's another one. Brain just slipped me. The copper oxide, some work has been done on it, variable results. Yeah, I mean, there's lots of published papers. You can look at it, tons of them. I read tons of them. Variable. Some had good results, some did not, right? And also with sheep, you better be careful with the copper oxide because of the toxicity, right? A lot of work was done on lespidiza. Actually, the one that shows the best results is the lespidiza. It's a legume, but it also is a legume with a high for tannins. So the tannins is actually, you know what, tea, when we drink tea, regular tea, and you get that dark coloring in the tea that gives it its bitterness, that's tannin. So what they know with the lespidiza, it's actually the tannins in it. And I think that's what works with the neem also that you all are working on in Cardi. The neem has high tannins. So the tannin, it's so bad tasting, it actually, they say, cuts the fertility of the female womb. So more work has been done on the lespidiza and tannins than the, better results have been seen, sorry, with the lespidiza and tannins than copper oxide, okay? And again, it has to do with the fertility of the female womb, okay? Cardi is doing some work on the neem and garlic also, and they seem to see good results with the neem so far, extract from the neem tree. So what I was telling you, young, now adults need to be checked once a month, but again, you don't just, Famacha is not just about the eye, it's also about the whole animal. So if I see a female that I see, which is pale, is red in color, but she looks skinny, which is very uncommon though, I'm just saying to you. If she's, you know, pinkish, but kind of slim, maybe she's lactating, I will still deworm her, okay? Not because she's pink mean I don't deworm her. You have to look at her general body condition also, all right? And with young animals, you actually need to check every 2 weeks, okay? But I don't do that because I kind of, you know, I'm lazy a little bit. But I'm going to tell you, you should check every 2 weeks, but at least once a month, please. But during my lambing season, which is now, which was in February, I would say I might go in there once a week and just give everybody a quick look over also. The lambs are easy to grab. Other things you can do besides Famacha is your fecal egg counts. I don't know if we'll be able to do that today. We're trying to arrange it. And also you look for your clinical signs. If you see the animal having diarrhea, again, if she's pink, minus in she had just a load of fresh grass, wet grass, then you need to deworm her. All right? So other things too, besides just the color of the eye. Okay?